Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS current affair analysis for 10th September 2020 and these are the articles we'll be dealing today. The first article for the day is taken from the Hindu and it is titled In Blockchain Voting, Leave Out the General Election. Now, in order to understand what are the various steps that are involved in taking voting online or electronically, let us try to understand certain points. The first one is you have to register voters who are eligible to vote, then confirm the voter's identity and anonymously and securely transmit vote from voter to ballot box, report vote tally at the country and state level, and then finally count and verify the votes that were cast by the central reporting authority. So these are the various steps involved in an election. Now with the rise of technologies like blockchain and with the rise of Bitcoin, the application for voting has already caught the attention of European Parliament. Their internal think tank published an assessment on the applications of blockchain for voting. And a minority party in Denmark has already implemented blockchain for an internal election. So what makes blockchain so appealing? What exactly is blockchain? Let us have a look into this. One of the fundamental reasons why many countries were pushing for increasing the adoption of blockchain is because the desire to increase voter turnout remains strong and the number of online voting pilot projects rised in countries like US. Also, some security experts warn that any internet-based election system can be rigged and it can be attacked regardless of the underlying infrastructure, despite saying that blockchain is very safe. What is the attraction with blockchain? It's a technology that can allow individuals which are carrying out a transaction. So whether we're talking about companies making transactions or individuals making transactions, you basically need a common platform. Like say for example, if you're using Amazon service, it is a sort of a marketplace which connects the sellers with the buyers. Now, in the presence of blockchain, this third man or the middle party is taken out. So it's a technology that can allow individuals and companies to make instantaneous transactions on a network without the need for this third party or middleman. So the transactions made on blockchain are completely secure, as the function of blockchain technology is to keep a record of everything that happens. So when a transaction happens, a copy of that is spread across all the connected network. So the main issue is the issues around online voting include server penetration attacks, client device malware, denial of service attacks, and other disruptions. So all the associated problems that are infecting voters' computers with malware or infecting the computers in the elections office that handle and count ballots can be a problem even in blockchain going forward, according to cybersecurity experts. So say for example, if we asked about a comment the other day, a US technology policy committee head said that if I were running for office and decided to use blockchain for that election, I would be scared. So if a technology expert is saying this, we have to rethink. This article also gives one example as to how a Russian media outlet has raised concerns about the potential threats that online voting or electronic voting can pose. So one of the essential features of blockchain is the fact that it is cryptographed, or cryptography is the basis on which secrecy and anonymity is maintained. Now this report by the Russian media outlet saying that we can actually decrypt the message has twofold implications. One, there is a possibility that political parties might identify the voters who are not voting for them, and if they win, there is a possibility that they can harass the voters who did not vote for them. The other possibility is, after decryption, they can turn it against the person as well. So in the Indian context, citing the pandemic, there is a widespread talk about adapting information technology based voting. So any online system is a threat at this moment. Now, how do we ensure that these problems don't recur? Are we suggesting that we should not adopt this technology at all? The author does not suggest that. He only suggests that we have to implement this technology at local level elections, for panchayat elections, for urban bodies, and then trying to understand the problems that they brought out, we have to correct on them and then move to the next level. Directly implementing it at election, general election level, at national level, would be a serious mistake without testing it on the ground. That is the implication and gist of this article. The second article is taken from the Indian Express and it is regarding the Maratha quota. So we know that Supreme Court has referred to a constitution bench to decide whether states can exceed this 50% quota on reservations set in the Indira Sawhney case of 1992. Maharashtra government gave reservation to the Maratha community, and ironically, Marathas are politically dominant community who make up to 32% of the state's population, and they have been identified as a forward caste, and they had agency to almost all the factors that are considered to be required for holding power, whether it is land, whether it is government post, whether it is significant number of people who are carrying out businesses. So there is a clout of influence in the community. While the division of land and agrarian problems over the years have led to a decline of prosperity among the middle class, and this has led to discontent that they are not able to get access to the power and the jobs that they historically held, the second phase of protest movement started in the recent times, which has led to increase in the number of suicides as well. So in 2016-17, there was this Maratha Kranti Morcha, a silent protest which witnessed support from the farmers of Marathwada region, which had a lot of farmer suicides because of the drought that they faced in that particular time. So they politically mobilized this and garnered into a movement, and that particular time the government had no other option to stop the protest, and they took a short route of announcing that they would give reservations to the Marathas. So a bench of Supreme Court heard a batch of petitions challenging the reservations for Marathas in education and jobs. So the petitions appealed for 2019 Bombay High Court, and they upheld that Socially and Economically Backward Classes Act 2018 was also challenged in the same court along with the same case. So the Supreme Court was supposed to give out its judgment on this issue. Before this, Bombay High Court had separate ruling. So in that case, Bombay High Court said that 16% quota granted by the state was not justifiable. However, the 16% was reduced to 12% in education and 13% in government jobs, as recommended by the Maharashtra State Backward Commission. So the bench ruled that the limit should not exceed this 50%. However, in certain exceptional circumstances, the limit can be crossed subject to availability of data. Now, whether this ruling will be upheld or not will be decided by the Supreme Court. So this is the issue background for Maratha quota. Let us keep a tab on this issue to understand the repercussions that Supreme Court judgment will have on the entire idea of reservation in India. That's it for the day. Thank you.